Hey, turn with me to the fourth chapter of the Gospel of Mark. And as we get started here, just want to say to all of you, happy 28th church anniversary, Grace Evangelical Baptist Church. Amen. Amen. Give yourself a round of applause just for being here. It truly is a blessing to be in existence today. Don't you think? Because it did not have to be. It did not have to be. This morning I want to speak to you from the subject, change or die. And we want to focus on how to access the power of the higher mind, the power of your higher mind. In essence, what I want to share with you and begin to make all of you aware of is that there's more to reality than the reality in which you experience in your waking mind. There's more to you than what you experience in your waking self, in your awakened mind self, your conscious mind. And those other levels of reality, those other levels of mind are more real as the reality in which you are experiencing now. And I want us to focus on accessing that level of reality, that those higher levels of mind that are you, in order to deal with the problems and the situations that we face in this world. The other day, I came across a quote that says, "The best ships are those who can withstand the winds." One more time. The best ships or boats are those that can withstand the winds. Now, when I saw this quote, I thought about it, tried to understand it. What is the author of this quote trying to say? The best ships are those who can withstand the winds. Now, from a human, earthly perspective, it would imply, that quote would imply, that the key to surviving life is about acquiring and accumulating building material possessions, and being able to fashion those possessions into a vessel of life that can serve you and protect you from the challenging winds of life, those forces of life, those inevitable external challenges in which you face in life. What the writer seems to be saying is that in order for you to be able to withstand the buffeting and the beating of life, its external forces, is that you must build the kind of ship made out of the best material that life can provide to keep from sinking. In other words, the better your ship, that is, the more money you have, the more education you obtain, the more material possessions you possess, all the necessary things of life that you can acquire, and even the more skilled you are, the more likely you are to be able to face the forces of life when they come against you. Because for sure, life will come against you. That's what I seem to understand from that quote. And I think that for the most part, many of us have been raised with that mentality. Would you not agree? And to that end, we teach our children, get a good education. Because a good education is the key to the future, to be able to survive on this earth. We tell our young people to save their money. Because being broke is no joke. We inform our young people and say, learn how to relate to people. It's not what you know, it's who you know and how they know you. We teach our children an ethic, what they call the Protestant work ethic. If you work hard, you'll make it in life. In other words, those ideas become the ships that we ride in. And we expect that if you work hard, if you have money, if you have skill education, if you know how to, you know, influence people, that when life comes against you, and it will, when forces of life come against you, and it will, you'll be able to withstand it. Now, underneath this philosophy, or that quote, the philosophy of that quote, is an idea that certain things will come against you, and they are to be expected, and they are inevitable forces of life. So the best advice you can give someone is to prepare by building and surrounding yourself with a strong ship that can withstand these winds of life. And yet, in 2014, what do you see happening around you? Many ships that we assume that have been strongly built are falling apart, sinking against the rocks of life. Have you looked around you today? Even our most well thought out and built up ships of life are toppling over. It's not just the poor man's ship or the undereducated or the uneducated person's ship, people of color, who we expect that their ship will fall and sink. But even the wealthy man, the educated man, the man who's well connected, they are experiencing turmoil and crises of their life. America is in a massive downfall. Everything that we believe and every ideal that we have put our faith in historically is being shaken and is shifting. You've heard me say other times, if the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? And we are living in a time where the very foundations of our society, the very foundations of our Christian religion, the very foundation of our economic policies are being challenged and are coming apart because of winds that are blowing against the American family, American society, Western civilization of life. Drug addiction of all kinds are affecting not just poor, uneducated, urban people, but if you talk to a lot of people who live in suburbia America, who have money beyond money, they, their families and their children are dealing with serious addiction. Violence is not just limited to the ghettos of America where poor and black and Hispanic people live, but violence has penetrated suburbia, the gated communities of our city. They have violence operating with them. You may not see it many times in the statistics, but there's a tremendous amount of domestic violence happening in manicured, gated communities that are happening. A lot of unhappiness exists among many of the bourgeois class of people. A lot of women are on Valium, all types of drugs, trying to cope with domestic violence in their lives. Fortune 500 companies are going bankrupt, just like the poor mom and pop shops in our community. Amen? And in all our efforts to withstand the winds of life, people's boats are sinking, even those made from the best building material. People don't realize that even the Titanic as indestructible as it was alleged, was only indestructible until it found an iceberg that sunk it. So what are we to do if the foundations are being destroyed? If the very climate upon and ideas and philosophy upon which Western civilization was built upon, if they are in the midst of a free fall down fall, what are we to do? Hence the sermon. Change or die. Change or die. These situations are happening for a reason, brothers and sisters. Maybe we are being asked to change our way of life. Maybe what we are witnessing in the fall of Western civilization is a call by higher forces that we need to change the way we are thinking. Maybe our thinking is too rigid, too stuck in our ways, and maybe we are being asked to become more flexible or to go to another level of thinking. You've heard me say over and over again the quote from Albert Einstein, what? The problems we face today cannot be solved at the same level of thinking we were at when we created them. Maybe the reason why so many of our marriages are failing, religions are losing their power, economies are going bankrupt, is because we are being asked to change our relationship to life itself. And the problem is, the more we resist, the more the problems are persisting. Maybe our focus needs to shift from not building a better ship to being able to calm the winds and the waves. Maybe we are being asked to go to another level of being. Mark chapter 4, verse 35 through 41. Even though sister read the verse pretty good, it's sufficient. I just want to put it on the tape, and I want to read it for our audience. It says in Mark 4, verse 35 through 41, it says, on the same day when evening had come, he said to them, let's cross over to the other side. Now when they had left the multitude, they took him, that's Jesus, along in the boat as he was, and other little boats were also with him. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so that it was already filling. But he, that is Jesus, was in the stern, asleep on a pillow. And they awoke him and said to him, teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? Then he, Jesus, arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. But he said to them, why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? And notice their response, verse 41. And they feared exceedingly and said to one another, what manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey? There are three things I want you to notice in this passage. The first thing is the command to let go on the other side. Life is a journey. And sometimes the best lessons in life cannot be learned by reading a book, even the Bible for that matter. Sometimes the best lessons in life can't be learned in a classroom, but they can only be learned in the journey of experience in life. Now, in the previous verses, Jesus had taught the parables about the kingdom of heaven. He He was on land. And I can see the people sitting there on the land, listening to Jesus talk, having their notebooks, their pencils, their pens, their notebooks ready. Because see, we're the kind of people that like to go to seminars. We like to go to conferences, like to come to church, like to take notes and listen to other people speak to us. And we assume that because we've heard a master teacher tell it, or we've read a great book, a bestseller, say it or write it, or we have been in the company around the people, we assume that because we're in the crowd that we know the lesson. But there's a difference between learning on land and learning on the sea. Does anybody know the difference between being on land and being on the sea? You see, land by its very nature has the appearance of being stable, still, sturdy. You can relax because land seems to be dependable. But there's something else that happens when you get on a boat, on a ship. Have any of you ever been on a cruise, on those big cruises? Some of y'all have, I'm sure you have. Yes. And when you're on land and you look at that cruise ship or whatever, if you happen to look at one of those military, I forgot the technical name for it, ships or whatever, they look huge. They can be like the size of 4 football fields. But when you look at them on an ocean or in a sea, the sea can lift that ship up. I've been on one, and I've been seasick. It can lift it up. It's hard to maintain your footing. That's what it's like when the Lord told the disciples, get in the boat. Because here we're going to truly begin to understand, if you really do understand what you have just said you understood when using the class. You got to get in the boat. And all of us, I'm sure, who have lived long enough, know that life can be like a wave. It can take you up and it can bring you down. It can be unpredictable. Water represents movement, change, unpredictability. But the fact is, because you are here and you've been born in the third dimension, you got to get in the boat. Now, as the story goes on, what happens? Just like you would expect when you get in a boat and things are unpredictable. Verse 37, verse 38 says, it says, and a great windstorm arose. And in those times, you ask the question, where is God when things don't go as planned? When things don't go as expected? Out of nowhere, a storm arises, and the storm that was not there is now here. The storm is more than what I expected. See, a lot of times we get in our boats called life, and we build our education, and we go and get our majors, and we say, well, I suspect that if I major in psychology, if I major in basket weaving, if I major in this sport, and this college and everything, that I can expect a job is going to be here. I can expect a job is going to be here. A lot of young people today go to college and they expect that because they went to college, they're going to have a job. But have you ever figured out, did anybody ever tell you that you were not promised a job? There's nothing written anywhere that says because you went to school, they admit that you're going to get a job. If you ever leave Pine Bluff and go to the East Coast, you'll discover that there are people walking around with PhDs working in some service industry job. So it's not just the person who has a high school education that can experience unemployment. And yet, there are people who have PhDs that experience unemployment. What I'm trying to tell you, life can throw a curve at you when you're in the journey of the experience. Things don't always go like you planned. People marry with great intentions. They really do like each other, infatuated by each other, have a kind of puppy love toward each other. But you don't always, life, marriage doesn't always go like the wedding. Life does not always go, marriage doesn't always go like you had hoped.
like you're playing.
People change. Things happen. And we make vows on the land in the wedding, ignorant of what can happen when you get in the boat after everybody says, you know, happy marriage, and they throw rights at you. Next thing you know, that rights, you be kind of collected because you need something to eat. You know. You discover when you get out of life that all the things you had put in your boat, all the emotions and the ideas and the thoughts and the money and the people you had, you discover when you get into the real life situation that you did not have enough money. You did not have enough spiritual understanding and growth. You did not have enough of whatever it is that you planned. You don't have enough, and you run out. And yet now you're out there in the middle of the ocean, and there is, on the sea, and there is a storm going on, and you don't have all that you need to make it. I'm not making this up. Do I have any witnesses here this morning and say, man, that's the truth? Amen. Amen. It's in moments like these where you realize you have put your best of heart and your best of skill and intentions in the building a kind of boat in life that you thought could withstand the challenges of life. I mean, you got friends in high places, you got ancestors, you got money, you got all that kind of stuff going on, and yet you discover that whatever you thought would work cannot work against the condition in the real time and space in life. It's in those times you look for your external God, the God that you were raised up with, the God from childhood. You look up based upon your understanding that God is supposed to be there, and guess what? God is not there. God appears to be silent. It's in moments like that that you begin to question. Has anybody here ever questioned the God of your understanding? Well, see, if you have not, then I really question whether or not you really have a relationship with God. Because it is necessary in order for you to grow that you have to doubt the God of your understanding. And notice what I called it, the God of your understanding. Because all that is happening is that your level of understanding is being challenged. I like the quote that's found, that is often quoted or committed to the teacher, the great teacher, the Gautama Buddha. Buddha said this, believe nothing. Question everything. Doubt is the door to wisdom. That's a very deep statement, because what I understand that to mean is that maybe the problem that we are experiencing is a result of our rigidity, our being inflexible, our belief in certainty that God is trying to shake up. Because many times, brothers and sisters, we approach the mystery of life as if we know it all. As if we know what God is really doing. And sometimes I believe God gets quiet in the midst of a crisis in order for us to rediscover our relationship and to expand our awareness of the mystery of life, the mystery of ourselves. Because when you're on the land, you take things for granted. You take things for granted. You assume that you got it. You assume that you know it. You assume that there's nothing else to learn. Because we have certainty. I find that when people are uncertain, when they are not sure, that's when they actually work harder, strive more, explore more. Doubt is the door to wisdom. I believe for the most part we are stuck, if you will, in the rightness of our own certainty. And where was Jesus? In the midst of the crisis. He's asleep. Jesus is symbolic. You've heard me say over and over again, Jesus is symbolic of the higher potential of Christ in every one of us. But Jesus is asleep, meaning that Jesus is lying dormant. He's inactive. As a result, the disciples who represent other areas of our mind are not accessing the deeper part of our potential in the Christ mind. And the disciples were stuck in low-level human thinking that we call inaction. It's in that context when they ask the question of Jesus, "Cares not that we perish?" And you can see in the story, Jesus wakes up. He's been asleep. The storm is going on, and the Christ is asleep. It's as if, in the midst of chaos, in the midst of crises, Christ is still. Did you see that? In the midst of crisis, in the midst of chaos, Christ is still. It's as if there's a peace in Christ. There's a peace in that level of mind that is not fazed by what's going on externally. The disciples wake Jesus up, and Jesus wakes up, and he looks at the boat, looks at the situation, and he just simply says, "Peace, be still." Jesus speaks to the storm. He speaks to the waves. He speaks to the wind. And when all else is moving, the higher mind is still. It's not in fear. It's not worried. What that means is, as long as you and I are in the lower levels of mind, the more that we are attached to reality of our own conscious mind, the more our eyes are fixed on the moving and the flowing and the changing and the moving of life, because that's the reality of this life. Things come and things go. War happens, peace comes behind, war comes again. Time to be born, a time to die. A time for embracing, a time for stop embracing. Life always is moving and ebbing and flowing, going up and down. But the reality is, when you get into the higher mind of your Christ potential, it doesn't change. And it is important for you to understand, brothers and sisters. It really is important for you to understand. No matter what has happened in your life, no matter what is going on in your life, God has not changed his relationship to you. It's only when we are in those lower minds, we assume God's relationship to us has changed. And when we stay in that mind, life seems to be like a rocky road, like a wave tossed to and fro, and we don't have stability in us. And that instability is reflected in how we respond to the movement of the world. What am I trying to tell you? The disciples said it right. When he calmed the sea and stilled the waves, they said, "What manner of man is this?" You see, the kingdom of heaven is truly within you. You are more than the stories you've been told. You are more than, there's more to learn about the mystery of God and life than you ever can imagine. The truth behind the parables of the kingdom is not that the kingdom is an external world that you're waiting to come. The kingdom is an internal world. So no matter how much you kind of build better ships, better external reality, until you have developed the internal reality, until you have tapped into that, you will not be able to have the peace you're looking for until you connect to the higher worlds of reality. This is, what I'm talking about is simply this. We must be able to do what is called inner alchemy. When we change the way we look at the world we look at changes. I want you to keep in mind, brothers and sisters, the peace that Jesus had was reflected in the power that he had to calm the external world. The crisis or the chaos in the disciples' mind was only demonstrated by the chaos in the external world of the sea. In other words, what I'm saying to you is that our external environment is a reflection of what's going on in us. If there's a storm in you, there will be storms about you. But if there's peace in you, you'll have the power to extend that peace outside of you. This is the role of what is called the alchemist. Any of you ever heard a book by Paulo Freire called The Alchemist? Anyway, it's The Alchemist. You and I are being challenged to become an alchemist. Alchemy is the foundation of what we call chemistry. The word alchemy is a compound word. Look at the word, spelled A-L-C-H-E-M-Y, alchemy. Well, the prefix al is the same word that we use for God. El means God or light, okay? Chem is the word that means black. This is why ancient Egyptians were known as Chemites. They were from the land of Chem. Alchemy is the art or the practice of studying the black light, melanin, at its physical, mental, and spiritual levels. This is what our ancient Egyptians and ancient Ethiopian brothers, mothers, and fathers were doing. They were spiritual alchemists. They were spiritual scientists. And their study was the study of the laws, sometimes called forces, sometimes called gods, of the universe. This is why when you went to those spiritual schools, they had over the doorpost when the students who were able to get in, they read, it says, "Man, know thyself, and you will know the universe and its gods." They believed in this principle that you must write down, that you must understand yourself. It's called the principle of correspondence. As above, so below. As below, so above. As within, so without. As without, so within. Again, what am I trying to say to you? Is that the storms of life that we experience externally is a manifestation of the storm in our own soul going on internally. The weather on the outside is a reflection of the weather going on inside. As the Bible says, as in heaven, so on earth. The law of correspondence. The alchemist was a man or a woman who was more than a trickster or just a low-level scientist who would try to change lead into gold. What the alchemist was a person who understood that he must raise his own consciousness, his own mind, from the lower level, like lead, to the higher level, like gold, and bridge those two together. That as above, in your higher level of consciousness, heaven, you can bring heaven to earth, and you can take the lower level of your experience of reality, and you connect it to heaven. It was about becoming one within yourself. It's about bringing heaven to earth and earth to heaven. That's what an alchemist was doing. It's about an inner transformation. It's about being able to change yourself from within. Today's problems are calling us. You have to change or die. By assessing change, by assessing the power of your higher mind, your divine potential. Now, you may say, well, then how do we do that? There are three things that I believe that you and I need to do in order to access our higher God potential. I say again, you are more than you think. There's a higher level of reality you can tap into if you choose to. Otherwise, you will die. This is why it says very clearly in a lot of our teachings, what does it say? it says you have to know how to be in the world, but not of it. An alchemist understood how to be in the world, but not let the world be in it. Because the alchemist understood how to change itself. Any of you get a chance to go online or go to my Facebook page, I put an article on there yesterday called The Gnosis of Slavery. Because one of the things that bothers me that I see in our black community when we begin to do black history programs is that we are stuck. We are stuck in the pain of the past. When I look at a lot of people and I listen to them talk, we are always stuck in the pain of what happened. And we don't know how to do alchemy. We don't know how to transform pain into power. We don't know how to transform misery into ministry. We don't know how to do that. That's alchemy. So how do you do that? Number one, you must learn to reframe your life. You got to reframe it. In other words, when I say reframe, you have to begin to interpret it differently. You got to see it from a divine perspective. They meant it for evil. God meant it for good. We have to stop letting other people define our reality. Power is the ability to define reality and have others respond to your definition of reality as if it were their own. As long as you give people the power to write your history, as long as you give people the power to tell you how you feel or to tell you who you are, you will never be free because you're controlled by the power of another person's definition in you. And what I see in our community, we always start our history with suffering and pain in Africa, and we never try to understand the source of our suffering and pain from a divine perspective. Maybe consider this, that we as black people, in our primordial self, which is a part of your higher mind, in our primordial being, in our first being, in our divine beingness, maybe, most likely, we wanted to experience a fall into slavery because we had rolled so high in being the greatest kingdom of people all around. We wanted to experience what was it like to fall into darkness, to fall into servitude, to fall into... We did that. Why? So that we can also show a mystery of the greatness of God in us. What do you think the Jesus story is all about? God becomes man. God leaves heaven, the riches of heaven, and becomes like a slave man. For what purpose? So that he may rise up and discover a greater power in God that was previously unseen. So we have to begin to look at things differently. We are the answers to our own prayers. And I'm not talking about the lower mind answering prayer, but every time you pray, what you are doing when you pray and you ask and you seek and you knock, what you are doing, you are accessing higher levels of mind. Therefore, when you ask the question, not why am I going through this, but how can I resolve this? You begin to trigger within yourself through dreams and through visions and through searching. You begin to access that divine mind within you that begins to trickle down to your conscious mind from higher realities. It begins to trickle down answers that are coming through you called the Christ mind. The second thing after you reframe. Oh, let me say one thing about reframing that I didn't say. This is why the Apostle Paul says in Philippians 3:13, he says, forgetting those things which are behind, I press forward. It's not that the event didn't happen. It's just that it's being looked at and reframed in a different reality from the higher mind perspective. The second thing you do after reframing, you change, you begin to access your higher mind. You have to consider your relationships. You see, one of the reasons why we get stuck in lower mind, because we're always living among people of the same mind. But if you really want to make a change and go to the higher mind, you have to be into fellowship. You have to be into relate to people who are talking a higher thought. This is why Isaiah discovered about God. God says, my way is not your ways. My thoughts are not your thoughts. As high as the heavens upon the earth, so is my thoughts with yours. So my point is this. If you keep hanging around people who have low thoughts, low emotions, low desires, then you're not in the relationship, because a student is not beyond his teacher. Those who you walk with, you act like, look like, become like. Therefore, if you want to see progress in achieving higher level of reality, you have to begin to talk with, walk with, fellowship with people who are talking a higher story, a more profound understanding. You cannot train with mules and expect to run like a thoroughbred. So what do you want? You have to begin to go beyond saying, you do it for me as a dependent. Because many times when I look at our people and they talk and everything, they keep waiting for other people to get guilty or to feel sorry for them and say, I'm gonna stop treating you the way I've been treating you. Now, how long are you going to do that? Wait for people to get religion. You keep waiting for them to change before you do anything about it. And then the other problem we begin to act as individuals, as if I'm in it all alone. I can do it by myself. And you're doing it with a part of your mind that has little power. Often we have to begin to become interdependent, develop an interdependent relationship with high-minded people and with God. In other words, God in me, God operating through me, God operating as me. This is the kind of relationship we must develop with higher spiritual frame of references. We must take away time from people who are going nowhere, doing no thing. Psalms 1, verse 1. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, or sits in the seat of the scornful, or walk in the path of sinners, but his delight is in the light of the Lord, and in that law he does meditate day and night. So where are you spending your time? Who are you spending your time with? What television shows are you watching? What people are you hanging around with? What are you doing with your time? If you spend your time in high progressive thought around highly progressive people, the blind can't lead the blind. Will they not both fall in the ditch? So why do you keep talking to, walking around, conversing with blind people who don't know where they're going, and they can't take you where you want to go? We have to begin to cut loose the energy vampires. People who always drain you of your emotional, spiritual energy. You got to break that relationship. I know it's difficult because they're your friends, they're your family. They're the people that you say that you love. But if you really want to access higher minds of God consciousness, you have to obey the word of Christ. If you love mama or daddy, sister or brother more than me, you're not worthy of me. Let the dead bury the dead. See, this lifestyle of accessing the higher realms of your potential is not for weaklings. It's not for those who are full of fear. You got to have courage, and you got to be willing. You got to be willing to want to go to higher levels of being. And until you're ready to draw the line in the sand, it's not for you. Then you must take your chance with your ship on the sea with a storm. And then finally, it takes repetition. We said you got to reframe, you got to have a relationship, and then ultimately, you got to have repetition. In other words, you got to establish consistent spiritual rituals. of prayer, meditation, service, and dietary practice. And you got to do it over and over and over again until it becomes second nature. Until it becomes when you see a storm happen, when you see a crisis like a breakthrough, when you are in the midst of something that's going on around you, it's like you have peace in the midst of the storm. You're open to higher realities, and therefore, when a crisis happens, you don't see it as chaos, you see it as potential for you to speak the word of God, and you can speak to the storm, and the storm will obey you. So what am I trying to say to you, brothers and sisters? I'm trying to say to you what it said in Philippians 4:13. And what does it say? It's a beautiful word. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. The I we're talking there is not that little personality that your mom and daddy named. It's not your little fraternal, little sorority identity that you walk around with. It's not your little church identity that you walk around as a badge of your spiritual identity. It's not that. That cannot do all things. That will succumb to everything. Let a little wind blow, let a little change happen, and you off and gone again. How many times over the last 20 years have I seen people come in and come out, come in and come out? Here some days, gone the next 5 weeks. You know, how many times have I seen that? When the least little thing happened and blow in their life, they give up their Bible, so they give up their prayer life, their meditation, their church life. They give it all up, cannot stand it. Why? That's an indication that's not that you're a bad person, not that you're an evil person. It's an indication that you need to go to a higher level of being. Because the difficult problems of the day cannot be solved at the same level of thinking that you were at when who created them? When you created them. Yes, you can if your mind is in Christ. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. You can't do it in the human ego. If you do, you're no different than the Titanic. All you're doing is waiting for the next iceberg to hit, and it will sink your ship. All I'm trying to tell you, brothers and sisters, as I close out this moment, step up to your power. God bless you.